at me. Actually, my wife and I, we run this small, we run a charity organization. I have a company that's also somewhat the same name, Ashanti Graham. Ashanti is my daughter, Graham is my son. But we also run this sort of workforce training organization as well. One of the things we are really passionate about is actually training soft skills. Not technical skills, but the non-technical skills, the ability to communicate effectively and stuff. And that's a major, major issue in Nigeria. Because I came back, that's one of our major problems. Customer service, the ability to communicate effectively, manage resources and materials and stuff. Major issues, something we are really passionate about. Yeah, that's it. Next slide, please. Okay, so this is what we are actually talking about. Stroke, assessment and response. The response part is so, so important. Okay, I know some of we all have a general idea of assessing these patients, but the response part is extremely important. So simple, and somehow I'm going to be focusing on that. Usually when I give talks like this, I like it to be engaging. Because I like all of us to actually be talking about it together. Because we look at something, somebody talks and stuff like that. Now, to tell the truth, it's not an exam. We're not assessing anybody. Okay, so if you actually know the answer, actually say it. Okay? We all want to be involved with this. I'm looking forward to a situation where this talk actually truly changes things. I will actually work with some of the things I will talk about here. That's really important. Next slide. Okay, so we're going to be doing a little bit of neuroanatomy. Now, one of the major problems is this. I was speaking to the medical director the other day, and he was saying something about, care in Garikel 2 is consultant-led. Okay, nice words. But in reality, at 6 p.m., 7 p.m., 8 p.m., 9 p.m., 10 p.m., over the night, how many consultants are you going to see on the ground?
None.
So in reality, it's you guys who are on call that are going to be there. So that means that you guys have to have a basic understanding of some of these scans. If not, the patients die. That's really, really important. You need to actually be able to look at this guy and say, this looks like something worrying. So let's do a little bit of neuroanatomy. What do you think this is, looking at that scan? All these scans are being shown as CT scans. So let's just start with that. All CT scans, okay? We have a CT scan in this hospital, don't we? And we send patients for scans, isn't it? Good. So what do we think that is? What do we think that is? It's not an exam. Anybody knows, just say, what do you think that is? What are we looking at in the first place? If we are fast, because there are lots of scans, there are lots of slides, so the faster we are with this, the better. What do you think this is? The subarachnoid hemorrhage. Why do you think it's subarachnoid hemorrhage? You think this is blood?
Yes.
You think that's all blood, isn't it? Right? You're absolutely right. This is subarachnoid hemorrhage. Okay? Next slide, please.
Yeah.
What do you think this is? What do you think this is? Sir, what do you think this is? You don't have a clue. When you're on call, you have to go to see scans like this. That's why it's really, really important that you actually... Because when you're on call, right, and you actually look at this scan and look at the patient, if you cannot say, hey, this is probably this, then the patient suffers. That is the truth. You're not going to get any radiologist who's going to come and look at the scan in a minute. True or false? You're not going to get any radiologist. Sorry. So, what do you think this is? You don't know. I love that answer because when you say you don't know, you don't know. It's better than faffing around.
Yeah.
It is a subarachnoid hemorrhage again. Look at the blood there. Subarachnoid hemorrhage. What are these black things?
Ventricles.
The ventricles, isn't it? The water space in the brain. Okay? Do you think the size of this ventricle is normal?
No.
It's diabetes. Is it? So what do you call that?
Ventricles.
Okay, next slide. Because when you actually, when a patient comes into A and E and you go and look at the scan, I want you guys to pick these things up. You're picking it up will make a massive difference to the patient. Please, think this is really serious. What do you think this is? What do we think it is and where do we think it is? Guys, there are many slides. Guys, what do you think this is? You're going to be seeing them when you're on call. Or when the A&E people call you and stuff, you're going to be saying, what do you think this is?
It's a bleed.
It's a bleed. Fantastic. Where is the bleed?
Intracerebral.
Okay. Absolutely right. It's an intracerebral bleed. Is it on the left or right side?
It's on the left.
Exactly, it's on the left side. When you look at scans, that's always left, isn't it? That's how it's always left. So it's a left intracerebral bleed or intraparenchymal bleed or whatever. Everything needs to be had at which part of the brain you think it's hitting. It's probably somewhere around the basal ganglia here, isn't it? Somewhere around there. What do you think this thing is here? It's a ventricle, isn't it? But it's not very black. Why is it not very black like the other ones?
Because I think it extended into the...
There's blood inside. Yeah. Interventricular blood as well. Okay, next slide, please. What are these ones? Well, we already know what they are. Is it their bleeds, isn't it? Okay, but where are they? Where's this one?
Intracerebral.
Yes, intracerebral. Where is it? Which anatomy now in the brain? Where is it in the brain?
Parietal region.
Sorry.
You said basal ganglia.
So yeah, this is basal ganglia. This is definitely basal ganglia. Classical basal ganglia. Globus pallidus, internus and externus, and your putamen, isn't it? That's what they are. Okay? Your cordial nucleus is usually somewhere there just aborting the arterial hormone ventricle.
Sorry.
Where is this one? Is it intracerebral? We know. See, go back one. No, go back. Okay, so this one. Once you see white, this is a bleed, and this is inside the brain. It is a bleed inside the brain. So next slide now. So we know that this is a bleed. We've established that this is in the basal ganglia, isn't it? So where is this one?
Thalamus.
Thalamus, yes, it is thalamus. Why do you say it's thalamus? Where do you find the thalamus? What is this black thing in the middle here? What are these two black things by the side here?
The lateral ventricles.
Yeah, the ventricles, isn't it? Which part, what do they call those ones, those ventricles?
The lateral ventricles.
Yeah, the lateral ventricles. Where do they flow into?
Aqueduct.
No? Where do they flow into? Exactly, the third ventricle. What is this in the middle here? The third ventricle. What is that anatomical the nuclei or whatever, or that structure? Because that is just next to the third ventricle. That is just next to the third ventricle. What do you call it? Third ventricle, there's just something by the side. Like this. What do you call it? It's the thalamus. Bam! That bleed is the thalamus. I'm just trying to teach you how to actually pick that. Oh, this is where the bleed is. So, this is the thalamus. The third ventricle is over there. What is this? Is the thalamus, isn't it? Now, bordering the thalamus, just around the thalamus there, is your basal ganglia. And there's usually something in between them, the internal capsule. So, if you see something very, very close to the midline here, the third ventricle, it is in the thalamus. If it's a little bit away, and you can sort of appreciate the thalamus there, it is in the basal ganglia. Okay? All these things we talked about so far, what's the cause? What's the main etiology? No, what's the etiology? What's causing it? Exactly, blood pressure. High blood pressure. Okay? Remember that someone who has had blood pressure for a long time probably is not controlling very well. What do you usually check for here? What do you check for in the radial artery?
Thickness,
atherosclerosis, isn't it? Yeah. Now, there are particular blood vessels in the body that happens to really quick, okay? They get atherosclerosis, they lose their elasticity, okay? So, the perforators that actually go to the thalamus and the basal ganglia, they are like that as well. They become atherosclerosis, and so they lose their elasticity. Mm-hmm. So, high blood pressure, no elasticity, going through the blood vessels, what's going to happen? It will rupture, isn't it?
Yes.
Isn't it? Common sense. Next slide. What is this one? Can you see the ventricles? That's how usually a normal ventricle would look, isn't it? So if you see a ventricle being relatively quite bigger than this, hey, it should strike something in your head. Okay? What do you think this is? Definitely bleeds, isn't it? Definitely intracerebral bleeds. Okay? Usually this kind of bleeds, this pattern is usually in patients who are hypertensive as well, but you call this amyloid angiopathy bleeds. Okay, they are usually in the periphery, subcortical and stuff like that. Okay, amyloid angiopathy bleeds. This is not the classical hypertensive bleeds are usually basal ganglia, thalamus, and the likes. Okay. Next slide. What's this one? You said, sorry. Yeah, so these are intraventricular beats. Common cause, agitation as well. Okay, intraventricular beats. So, in this kind of patient, the blood clot is there, it can flow down, block the fourth ventricle, or even cause inflammation around the brain where the CSF gets reabsorbed and the patient develops hypercapnia. Okay, next slide.
That is an emergency.
This kind of patient, I won't rush to do an operation for this kind of patient. But in another talk again, we'll talk about getting to the neurosurgeon's head. Which one will the neurosurgeon operate and why? We'll talk about it. But let's really concentrate on assessing the patient and responding. Part of responding is you actually looking at this guy and say, hey, I'm really worried about this one. We need to do something on time. That's why I'm showing you this. It's really important that you see this. I want you guys, when you see the patient, you also actually go. I prefer going to the scanner, although you have to speak to the radiographers nicely. Okay, I prefer going to the scanner, actually looking at the scan. Okay? Next slide. Where do you think that is? Can we see the bleed? Can we all see the bleed? Where do you think that is? Sorry. You can talk about the broad name of what you call that area, but you can talk about the specific name. What do you call that area? Is it brainstem, isn't it?
Yeah,
brainstem. So which particular part of the brainstem is it?
The
pons. Yeah, it's a pontine bleed. Okay? Depending on how this patient is presenting, sometimes when I see this kind of patients, I just tell the family, the chance of survival is very, very low. Okay? Because you know why? The brainstem houses all your key centers, isn't it? Your key nuclei that control your lungs, your heart, and stuff like that. And also, it's the same conduit for all your ascending and descending fibers as well. Okay? Major clockwork. Mm-hmm. Also hypertension processes as well. Next slide. Okay, two different scans. Where do we think those bleeds are? We've established that white things that is in the brain are bleeds.
Yeah.
We now know that white things are bleeds. Please. No, nobody has any. There's not an excuse anymore. When you look at that scan and you see something, it's a bleed. It's white. Besides, patients are presenting acutely, it will be white. So, the one on your left hand side. Cerebellar bleed. You're absolutely right. Cerebellar bleed. What's the problem with cerebellar bleed? There's a problem with cerebellar bleed. Your posterior, you know, you have the anterior cranial fossa, the medial cranial fossa, and then you have the posterior cranial fossa, just for the posterior fossa for short. The problem with the posterior fossa is that it's a really small space. Okay? So imagine a very small, compact space there. You don't add extra stuff to it, like a bleed again. And what is that thing usually in the middle there? What's it called? What's that thing in the middle there? At the base of the brain? Just behind the brainstem. And you sort of medial to the two cerebellum. What's that thing there? Anybody? Somebody? Anybody? It's the fourth ventricle. You know, the plumbing work in the head is these two lateral ventricles are producing this brain fluid or CSF. It flows into the third ventricle, through the foramen of Monroe, and then from there it now flows to the aqueduct of Sylvius into the fourth ventricle, and then from the fourth ventricle it follows the foramen of Magani and foramen of Lushka at the back, and it now goes around the brain and then goes down the spinal cord. That's how it flows, isn't it? Right. So that means CSF is going to flow through this fourth ventricle. What is this bleed going to do to this fourth ventricle? It's going to close it up, isn't it? What's going to happen to the patient? Can you say this is just common sense? You just think of plumbing work. Common sense. Okay? Really small space, the bleed comes in there, clots that up. If you do not do an EVD, this patient just goes down. So imagine you come and see a patient and they say, what is this? I don't know what's neurology review in the morning. By morning, your patient is dead. Again, we're talking about response. Where do you think that one is? You guys should be able to tell me this one. Where is this bleed now? Sorry. Yes, it's in around the fourth ventricle. Bang! It's just in the fourth ventricle. So what's going to happen to this patient? Hypercephalus. So imagine if you now wait, neurology review in the morning, you're going to write a very nice stuff that you're writing up and stuff like that. You know that? By the time you come in the morning, by the time your neurologist comes in the morning, the patient is dead.
Why is it not an hospital?
Why is it
not hospital?
So so we are now in the posterior fossa. Okay? We are in the suboccipital posterior fossa. So they have what we call the tentorium. Okay, the hospital rooms are on top of it. So this everything here is infratectorial. That's the word. Okay. All this is infratectorial, under the territorial. The hospital rooms are supratectorial. They are both territorial. Okay. Next slide.